I am here with Gabe, the Kerry Blue Terrier, and we are going to get this boy groomed. He is fuzzy, is he not? Say hi, Gabe. Hi. All right, let's get him in the tub. We're going to go ahead and wash and blow dry him before we do any trimming. That's a good boy. Good boy. Don't you go pee anywhere. Oh, no, you don't. Come on, Bubba. Let's go. Come on. Let's go. Hurry up. Good dog. Get back here. Get back here, Gabe.
Good boy. Oh, you're so sweet.
All right. You stay. Get you guys fixed so you can see. Here we go. Hi, Tina. How are you? Good boy. The dog on the cover is my dog, Hanna, when she was about 3 years old, 2.5. She won a 5-point major at that show. Good boy. He does have a lot of hair, doesn't he? It's gonna be fun to blow dry. I'm using iGroom prebiotic shampoo and conditioner. He's not bigger than Hanna, he's just got a lot more hair. Once I get him all wet down, he's gonna shrink. This will be a breed standard trim for him. Beautiful boy. I like him a lot. Turn. He is 4 years old. So I'll explain what I'm doing as I'm working on him, but I'm going to be very focused on this haircut. It's a very precise haircut, and being he has so much hair, it's going to be very challenging to pull it in tight. I've got him scheduled again next month, so next month's groom should be much tighter. I'm going to soap him up twice. He's quite dirty. I'm sure he plays outside a lot. There are some spray bottles in the very back around the corner, like where all the cooking stuff is.
Okay.
They're empty, and there should be sprayers with them. I need one filled up with water.
Sure.
And put on a heavy spray setting. Sure. And put in my room, because I got to wet down his coat after I get done scissoring
it. Water is fine.
Any water.
And they already paid, right?
No.
Okay. It has it checked out, and it was like a $20-something, $25.
Oh, I checked out the wrong person.
Uh-oh.
She always pays cash, so it don't matter. Oh, okay. Good boy, Gabe.
Last name is...
That is Izzy. It's a dog.
By herself?
Yeah.
Oh,
I should use your HV dryer for this one. Take a couple of these heavy bath mats in here, like three of them, and spread them out on my table too. Buddy. Good. Nice and clean now. So I'm going to move you guys back before he's tempted to shake. You stay there. Raise you guys up, and then we can zoom you in. Almost better. Now he can't shake on the camera. We don't want that to happen, do we?
with the clipper work as soon as I get him combed through.
Watch face when I'm spraying.
Probably healthier for me than jumble dust.
Just a little. I am using iGroom Wonder Spray. It's no longer available, so I'm using my stock on it that I was saving for my own dogs, but Gabe gets it because it's the perfect product for his coat type. His pet parents have already done his nails because they said he doesn't like it. So I'm going to use a 40 blade on his pads. Grab a couple cotton pads and wipe out his ears.
Absolutely. Oh my gosh. Hey, dirty.
I had to wash his face three times. He was a dirty boy.
You were dirty.
He was playing out in the yard, I think. You said the time allotment was 2 hours?
Yes.
Do I get any extra for overgrown coat?
Or matting?
Well, we're starting at the time of the pads being trimmed.
Oh, that's true. So, 4:25?
So, I've got till 6:30.
Timestamp that?
No, I'll just do 6:30. And you can text his owners and tell them they'll be finished at... He'll be finished at 6:30, so they know what to expect. So they gave me 2 hours, including the bath. Like, no. No. Don't think so. All right. So, the way I do the ears is I do a 40 from about the bend of the ear down. And then up closer to the head. Let me raise you guys up a little bit. Come here, buddy. Up closer to the head, I'm gonna pull the ear forward. And I like a nice arc around the ear, personally. So I'm gonna take a 15 blade and I'm gonna get all this out where the ear meets the head. And I actually take it a little further up into the head, not just where the head meets. But I will do that after I get some scissoring done, see right where I want to place it.
Oh, no, owner said okay.
All right. I just wanted them to have a heads up. I didn't want them to come back and at 5 o'clock and think he would be ready. Because he got here at 3. Alright, so now we're going back to the 40 blade. Ooh. Work on this other ear.
Over 100 watching and we have 66 likes.
Awesome, guys. Keep it going. So when working on ears, you go middle down, middle out, middle out, middle out, middle out. Never go up on an ear. Never go across on an ear. Always go towards the outer edge and towards the bottom and towards the outer edge. I'll probably go over all this clipper work as I'm scissoring him just to tighten everything up. Just kind of carving everything in right now, seeing where I'm going. So now I'm going to go back to a 15, pull the ear down and forward, get where it meets the head. I don't do a 15 in here, a 40 in here because it can get quite itchy. I'm going to use the 15 on his cheeks from the corner of the eye back towards the ear. Want a nice long lean head on these guys.
I can hang out for 10 minutes and then I'll be on the live. Miss Pammy says she received her groomer's harness anchor today and she said thank you.
You're welcome, Miss Sammy. And I'm working on Ann B's order to see what's going on. I haven't done it yet. I will reply back to that later today. After I finish Mr. Gabe here. So with the Kerry Blue, one thing that's quite unique to these guys is they're not a Wheaton, they're not a Bouvier, they're not a Schnauzer. You take this entire underside of the chin all the way up into the flue. Bring the whole thing forward. And I clear out that flue. Do the same thing on the other side. And then from the lip up to the corner of the eye is where I leave it a little further back and blend that with thinning shears, but basically that's the general idea. I'm bringing it down into a nice sharp V. And this is the first time I've done this dog, so I'm not... He feels like a nice substantial dog, but I'm not 100% sure on him. Just how tight we want to go. His breeder handler has kept a lot of coat on him. He was just shown about 6 weeks ago. So this is a lot of hair. If you look in between the back legs, the hair is just touching back here. So why she is keeping so much could have something to do with his conformation. I don't think so, but I think he's quite nice. I typically like to show off my dogs, and I like to see them move. I like to see their legs moving away from me. All right, so I'm taking, with a 10 blade, I'm taking the back of the tail up about a third of the way on the back here. They get completely cleaned out in here. You want to see all the way down to the skin on this back end. The inner thigh gets cleaned out. I'm going to clean out around his testicles.
I don't know if he gets sensitive around here. His breeder has left a lot of hair. And that's one of the things when you don't know a dog real well. You know, you learn things as you go about them, where they're sensitive, where they're not sensitive. But typically, these dogs are cleaned right out in here. As are most terriers, you clean out this inner thigh. You want to show these big, powerful thighs moving around. Now, with the underline in the belly, I'm kind of careful and I do my scissor work before I do any belly trimming because I want my underline to be very controlled and where I put it. Right? I saw it. I saw it. Do you like me now? Are we friends? Mm-hmm. Oh, he says, hey, lady. Hi. Okay. So, with my dogs, I typically like them right down close on the front end. And I don't find that they look very good unless you take it on down. And he seems to have a nice, quite substantial body, so I'm going to go ahead and do that. Yeah, they know about that one, too. Stay. So what I do, so I'm using a 5-blade, I'm skimming back here, and I am coming right on down. And if you can see here, see all this hair? I don't leave that much hair. So I want to see some chest on this dog. I want to see his shoulders. Because this is what's going to create this nice arch neck. And I think the biggest problem a lot of people have with this breed is not getting enough hair off of them. This underline shouldn't drop past the elbow, is way on down here. And I think he's plenty substantial enough of a dog to be able to be trimmed up. So, I'm gonna err on the side of caution, and I'm gonna go with a yellow comb, the zero, and I'm gonna round off under his rib cage. So I'm gonna start right where the rib cage starts to bend down, and I'm just gonna bring him on in tight here. Turn him around, do the other side. Now I'm staying well back behind the arm, and I'm staying in front of where I'm going to bring his tuck up. This is just to knock some of this hair off and get it where I need it to be. So I'm rounding it right on under. I like the Kerry Blue to have good terrier form. Just don't want them to be a big old shaggy dog. That's not what they're meant to be. They're meant to be a tight, well put together terrier. Angle this back a little because it's longer than the other blade. It's arching up his neck. All right, now
what are we gonna do? Now what are we gonna do?
Okay.
Scissors. Let's see if Zolita will cut them. This might work on his hair, I'm not sure. Put them down a bit, watch your legs. Table's coming down.
Well, I'll be on the live.
All right.
I gotta go.
Have fun. Hope it works out for you.
Of course, you do something cool.
You'll be able to watch.
Yeah. I love you. You have a good day.
You're so handsome. Bye, guys.
Have a good one.
Thank you.
All right, so I'm setting his top line. Starting right about from the hip bones up to behind the shoulder blade a good little bit. So basically, when I think about scissoring this dog, the around the body shape that I think of is a hexagon. So I go flat across the top, angle down into the sides, flat across the sides, and angle down under. I'm going to get most of this back and neck and sides scissored so that I can put the curl back in and let that be drying while I do his legs. So I'm using my curved shears backwards as I go to set in the neck. Make sure he's four square. I'm going to start angling this upward. I like a really nicely natural neck. Who are you and why? Seriously? I'm not expecting anybody. Do it. All right. So Jennifer and Chime, I got your package. I'm so impressed. Thank you so, so, so much. All right. So I like this neck nice and natural. Very, very, very elegant. Not flopping around. It's not a poodle, but it's definitely a very stylish neck. I'm
The reason why I start the top line in front of the hip bones is because I need to set this tail in properly when I get back there. So I'll set that back section then. So what I'm going to do here is I do this with the tail up and in place. And I'm going to come off each side of the tail with it in place so that I don't take off any of this right here where I need it to blend into his back. And I also don't want to narrow him down in the hips. So I want him nice and wide this way so that we have a nice powerful rear. Hence the hexagon shape. And I'm going to get you guys plugged in so I don't have any low battery problems that make us lose our videos. Let me do that real quick. Stay, bud. Stay. Hopefully that is plugged in properly. Back side of this tail for now I'm taking with a 5. I might go closer with a 7. We'll see. I'm just going to come straight up the back here. So I've taken this short, I've taken this short. Now I'm going to bring this straight on through so I don't narrow him down too much. I want him to look very powerful. So I'm coming straight up, not angling my scissors in, straight up. Go straight up all the way through. Just getting down in there, knocking some of this hair off. He's got way too much in my opinion. Okay, bud. I am using Zolita Mirage shears. They are 8.5 inches long. So I'm taking my shears straight up on the neck, not angling in, straight up.
again, because I don't want to lose any of the width. Now, when I get past the neck, now I'm angling this way to create that hexagon type shape that I was talking about. That way, when the dog moves, none of the side coat's going to be flipping up and interfering with this look. So in the National Dog Groomers Association guidelines for certification on this breed, where it says it should look like a well-tailored jacket, that's exactly what this breed should be. It's a very, very highly stylized dog. It's a gorgeous dog when it's all done. And they have their own style going on. Very unique. And like I said yesterday, I've had one of these dogs in my house for the last nearly 30 years. So let me drop you guys down just a bit. So you can see how thick he looks right here, how he doesn't have that terrier style. One of the things I like to do when I groom this breed is make it so you can see sharp angulation no matter which direction you're looking at this dog from. Getting this on down a little bit. This is looking a little off. This done first. So when I'm setting the back end, and this is a bit, advanced for some, but there's others that would need to know this or want to know this. So I'll show you how I do it. So you're creating a really wide rear with this dog. You want a lot of power back here, but that doesn't mean you have to have so much hair that you can't even see between the dog's legs. So how I create, and they're supposed to be well let down in the hocks, and you can see the person who's been showing him, which I'm not complaining about at all, but they've got all this hair and it's so much. This dog is supposed to be well let down in the hocks. Very well let down in the hocks. But the way I achieve that and create a wide rear and bring them way on in on the inside of the leg and way out on the outside of the leg to create that very powerful moving rear is I take the hock all the way down. So I have to reset the middle line here. So the hock is here. Actually, he's got a nice wide rear. I could probably put it right where it goes. Let's see here. So I'm going to come in just above that, and I'm going to create this line straight down the middle, creating this very well let down hock. But it's still got all its width. Then I'm going to take my shears and angle them this way, keeping that width. And start bringing everything forward this way, rounding it on in. get both these lines set before I do the inside of the legs. Behind here. So he has probably 4 inches of hair in there. I'm gonna get in here and get some of this out of here. So this dog grooming, and especially highly stylized dog grooming, is indeed sculpting. It is art, and it's fun. And this dog, he's very well trained. He's 4 years old. He's a bronze grand champion, so he doesn't need a lot of coochie cooing or good boys during the work because he is accustomed to standing and getting groomed for long periods of time. The better trained a dog is for this, the less you have to encourage them to stand. And they actually will wonder, well, what's wrong if you overdo it with them once they're trained? So definitely don't want them looking bowed out here. You want a nice, tight terrier style. You don't want hair flopping all around as he moves. So I start angling forward. Keep it wide. Then I get up in here. I start rounding it back in this way. Don't need all this. I don't know if you can see how much hair is there. Don't need that. We're gonna give him that little bit of waist that was talked about. Pulling this up and out. Hair off this front leg. It's a good boy. So now I'm taking my scissors in tight, right alongside this neck, and I'm creating his shoulder angles. And that also gives him some length in neck. I'm setting his front legs up under him. And now I can come under here. The Kerry Blue's front legs should swing loose like a pendulum. So they don't need all this up under here. I can get rid of some of that.
this underline should drop to the elbow. From the about the last rib. So his elbow's here, but you want to make sure it's, you know, keeps the dog in balance too, depending on the dog itself. So I'll go judiciously at first and then see how it looks in the end and see what I need to fix. You got to remember too with these dogs, you want them nice and tight, but you're going to be putting curl back in, which is going to tighten it up. And bring them in shorter looking. Let's turn around. This way. Come on. Good boy. Good boy. Good boy. Turn, 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 turn. Let's clean off this table. I can't see a thing with all this hair up here. No, I can't. I can't see what I'm doing. So I was talking to Barbara Bird this morning, and she said she gave us a shout out on their next podcast for the YouTube channel. Isn't that cool? That would be on the Groom Pod podcast. I'm like, you did? So I just thought that was awesome. So we may be getting a lot more people following pretty soon. A lot more groomers. Starting to take shape, huh? It's a big job. Ooh. Ooh. I wonder if he'd like to go with me to the National Dog Groomers Association.
Ooh. I could compete with you, Gabe. He's going to be getting neutered, though. You want to be my competition dog? Ooh. Now, I could go for that. Oh, yeah. Take Ammo and Gabe and a nice Bichon. Mm-hmm. Hmm. My wheels are turning. What do you think, Gabe? You want to be my competition dog? You know, they put these terriers in with poodles, or not poodles, but all other purebreds like Bichons. Like everything, hand scissors, all in the same competition class. I think the terriers should all be in terrier classes, personally. Again, I'm getting up under the arms so his legs can swing free of his body. Setting in his shoulder angles. Taking it tighter so that these angles pop. And it gives the neck more arch. Setting his front up under him a bit. Going straight on down, but we also want to see, we want to see the shoulder line and see the legs set up under him a little bit.
good boy. Yes, you're very, very good.
These are truly the most lovely dogs. And I'm surprised they're not more popular. You know, people just don't know about them. They don't shed. They have poodle texture hair. They're all terrier, but they're an all-purpose farm dog, so they're not that plucky kind of terrier, you know, like your wire fox and such. They're a good all-purpose dog. While he looks quite large, they typically weigh about 35, 40 pounds. You know, sometimes the boys can be a little heavier. So, you know, they're a great size. All mine have been fabulous with children. I mean, beyond fabulous with children. They're just a lovely, lovely breed of dog. They're not as silly as a Wheaton Terrier. They are much more laid back, in my opinion, than a Wheaton. More level-headed. They're very trainable. They just have so many good qualities about them. And to not see that many of them, you know, is kind of sad. I mean, I see a lot more Wheaton Terriers than I do Kerry Blues. All right. I'm going to work on the top of the head real quick before I set in some of that curl. So some people like to do a blade up here. Some people like to shave it like all the way back to the ears. Different people have different ways of doing this head. I'm going to start off with chunkers. And I like a bit more of a natural look, even though I like it really short. So I'm going to take my hand right about at the brow bone so that I can start the shortness right where the brow bone drops off. And some people take it back. Even the National Dog Groomers Association book was saying to take it back to the occiput. That's way too far back. I take it back to about where the ears start. And then I take my neck and blend it on up into it. Supposed to have a very long, lean head. So I'm still taking my curves backwards here on the back of the head. I don't know if I'm in your way or not, but I gotta have my arm in the right position, so I'm sorry. Then I drop the head down. Bring my curves on up in this way and follow through over the eyes. It should be a nice natural flow. It's not squared off like a Wheaton. It's not built out over the ears like a Wheaton. But what I like to do is when you're looking at the head straight on, once it's done, I like this area to add length to the entire head. So if you take it too short in here, you're shortening the head. So I like this head to look nice and long throughout.
I'm a little picky about my carries, as you can tell.
I wish I had some curved chunkers for this. I could really use those. Might have to invest in some. Good boy. Now I'm going to edge out the ears, make sure they're scissored nice and close, right up to the ear leather. Okay. When I said earlier that I left some of this hair till I could see what I was going to do with the head, I'm going to take this head and tie it up over these ears and on in behind. Shears, and I take my thinning shears and blend this hair from the clipped area up into the little bit slightly longer area, blend it right on down to nothing. So that you can't even see a transition line. Take the top of the head flat, real close right there. Blend these lines into the clipper, the long hair to the clippered hair. All right, I'll come back to that head later. I'm gonna go ahead and do his underline here, and then I'm gonna wet down his coat so that can be drying. While his coat is drying on top, I'll be working on his legs. I still haven't done his belly. I wanted to get all this underline created before I go in and do his belly so I can see exactly what I'm doing there.
taken shape. Alright, let's wet you down.
So I have just plain water in here. Brand new bottle, never been used before, so it didn't need any disinfectant from any previous uses. One of the main characteristics of this breed is his curly coat and his wave to his coat. And you never send them home blow dried. Turn, turn, turn. Turn, 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 turn. Their legs should be fluffy. Their head should be fluffy. Part of their tail. I wet them on down into like a terrier pattern. This breed must have his curl. Just gonna let all this air dry while I work on the rest of him, and then if it needs any air from the blow dryer when I'm all finished, I'll just put that on it for a few minutes and scrunch it dry. And that's what brings out more of that terrier shape.
You're not done yet. No, you're not. Don't get any bright ideas. We still got to do your feet. We got to do your legs. We got to thin out your beard. We got a long way to go. We're nowhere near done yet.
It's like a mega groom.
Alright. So now...
feet. You should see how much hair is on the floor already. I'm sure it would be possible to set up a site just for experienced groomers. I like everything I do on my channel to just be what I do. If people find it interesting, they do. And if they, you know, because there's sites like Amy's for beginners, where, you know, that's all that is focused on. I'm creating a new website called groomingsafer.com, and I am going to compile a lot of stuff there. Not just my stuff, but other people's stuff to have a resource. But, you know, there's sites like Learn to Groom Dogs, but, you know, they do charge quite a bit for their information that they share, you know. There are sites like that already where it's very detailed, but sometimes I just like to showcase some of this stuff that I do that's much more technical than, say, what sites like Amy's do, where it's more beginner level. Because naturally, this is a technical groom, very much so. But a lot of pet groomers, if they get one of these walking into the salon, they've got to have some idea what to do with it. And if you want to get certified as a pet groomer, you really need to know how to do some of these dogs. And speaking of Amy, she is coming on her channel live right now. So I don't blame a bunch of you if you want to jump over there and check it out. You can always finish watching this later if you want, because I'll upload it. But I will be creating a bunch of videos that are good for certification quality work, or, you know, next level work for sure. Sometimes when you see me looking at the phone like that, I'm using the phone like a mirror and seeing something from a further perspective that I want to work on. Right now, I want to see his angulation from that angle, not just from the side. So I am using my phone like a mirror and bringing this forward till I can see a well let down hawk from that angle, which I have achieved.
this front leg. So he's starting to get that terrier style, you know, instead of just being a mountain of hair. Let's turn you around. For certification time, what did we say? 6:30? Was that the amount of time we needed? I think that's what we told his owner. 6:30. I can't remember now. But he had way overgrowth of hair. So 6:30, I got enough time to finish him. Yay, I was hoping it wasn't 6. I'm like, I don't know if I can get it done by 6. So if you were in a dog grooming competition or you were getting certified with the National Dog Groomers Association of America, they would give you 2 hours to complete the groom after they're bathed and blow dried, the nails are done, and the pads are done. So you would have an allotment of 2 hours to complete the groom. So I am 1 hour in and making progress. So again, I want to see the angulation from, say, this angle. So I'm combing all this hair up and out. See how all this is blocking the view of the angulation? I'm bringing it on forward. For a well let down hawk. And see how I comb all this up? If you were in the show ring, all that hair blowing in the wind would make his hawks look a lot taller than they need to be.
So again, he's supposed to have a well let down hock. So we got to get rid of all this hair that would blow up in the wind and cause the judge to see a different picture than what you want to create. What's my favorite big dog to groom? Kerry's are my favorite medium-sized dog to groom. As far as big dogs, it would be a toss-up between a giant schnauzer or a German wire-haired pointer and standard poodle, of course. Guess I'd have to, for real, say standard poodle. For real. I'm scissoring for real. This is what you call scissoring for real. For real. The same with the inside of the legs. You don't want hair blowing up from the inside of the legs to cause that hock to look higher than it is too. Scissoring off all the hair that falls below the pad. Scissoring inside his front legs, good and tight. And see how much time his top coat has to dry while I'm working on these legs. So that was part of the plan to get all this done and wet and drying the curl in, because I have plenty of time. You know, if I were in a grooming competition, I would have an hour for the back coat to dry while I have time to scissor the legs and thin the head. So, part of it is planning your time accordingly, whether it's a pet groom, a show groom, or a competition groom. You know, you got to plan how you're going to complete the groom in time and have everything all in the right place. So I don't like how high this is looking right here. So I'm gonna have to go in and fix that because I don't like that angle upward. Sorry, buddy. He's a good boy. Oh, he's a good boy. Yes, he is. He's a very sweet puppy.
So if you remember, I took a 5-blade on the front of the body here, just leaving a little bit between the front legs, took the chest down. Now I'm dropping him straight on down to his toes. You want this just to be a nice continual line. He had a ton of hair up here he did not need. Now in between his front legs, he does not need a ton of hair there. And you don't want anything jutting out at the elbows. You want the elbows in nice and tight. So I take them all the way up in on either side of this piece of chest hair. Let's see if I can get you guys positioned better. It's kind of dark. He's a dark dog. I apologize for that. So I'm going straight up in here. And then you just want a piece of hair dropping down between to give him some depth of chest. And you want just a little bit of daylight in between these front legs so that you can see where his legs are. Too many people leave too much hair and you can't see the legs themselves. Thank you, Carrie. For me, when I groom a dog, especially a show dog, I want to see that dog moving, and I don't want, especially if it's a beautiful dog, a well-put-together dog, I don't want hair hiding the beauty of the dog. I want the hair to complement the dog, but I don't want the hair to overpower the dog or prevent the judge from seeing the dog as he is, you know. It's just like when I was grooming the Chinese Crested. He had so much mane that it was hiding his shoulder lines. And it was actually holding him back rather than adding to him. So I think he's got too much hair right in here. And he's got too much right here. So with his tail up, I'm now going to take it in tight on either side, just leaving a slight V in front of the tail. And that's going to keep his tail set on high, but get rid of this little bit of height he has here because this, he needs a little bit more of a slope in here. Nice level top line, but you don't want to see it rise up any in here. Top line is extremely important in most breeds of dogs. Well, all breeds, but it just depends on what kind of top line they're supposed to have, you know. And if they're supposed to have a level top line, you don't want any hair causing it to look like it's off. A gorgeous tail set, by the way. Perfect. Kerry Blue should have a straight tail. Not curled over their back, not dropped down,
set on high, and the straighter the better, the standard of the breed says. That's pretty nice. Should be, you know, any shade of blue, gray, gray blue, slate colored. The rear is supposed to be nice and wide and powerful. The front is supposed to drop straight off here. The chest is supposed to drop right to the elbow. They're supposed to have a waistline. Their front leg should swing like a pendulum, swinging independently of the dog. You know, these things you should know, because that's going to dictate to you. They're supposed to have well let down hocks. You know, all these things are going to dictate to you how the dog is to be groomed. Just like the Bedlington Terrier, same thing. All the things in the standard that tell you what the dog ideally should be are also going to indicate to you how the dog should be groomed. That was very rude. I should cut that out. But anyway, that's just the fact of it. Don't say you're not a show groomer. Say you're a groomer. And if you're a groomer, if you're a professional, and you say that you're a groomer, then you should have some basic understanding of the dogs that you work with. And you might say, well, I'll never see a Kerry Blue in my shop. Once people know you know how to do something, you'll start seeing them. You know, when I started learning how to do Bedlingtons, I ended up with like 17 Bedlingtons a month, every month. All regular clients coming from all over Central Florida. When people found out I learned how to do Kerrys, Kerrys came out of the woodwork. When people found out I knew how to do Wheaton Terriers, they came out of the woodwork. So, you know, you have to learn it and they will come. All right. Same when I did thick at the Cocker Spaniel, people would say, well, I'll never see a Cocker that looks like that, so why should I learn to groom it? Well, you don't get any like that because you don't groom it, because you don't know how to groom it. So learn, and then they will come. So I need more angulation right here. So to get that angulation right there, I'm going to angle my scissors this way, so I can still keep the width of the leg, but give you more curve here. I just hear that so much. I'm not a show groomer. Well, you're a groomer if you're a professional. And this is just a breed standard trim on Gorgeous Dog. But basically, you can make any Kerry Blue look stunning. They don't have to be a gorgeous Kerry Blue. They just have to be groomed. And they look stunning. So when I learned how to do this breed, I didn't have anybody show me. I had to buy my own Kerry Blue to learn how to groom one. I wanted to groom a Kerry Blue, and I couldn't. I didn't have any for customers, and that's how I ended up with my dog Hank, because I wanted to groom one so bad, and I wanted to learn how to groom the breed. Never saw one in a grooming shop, so I'm like, okay, well, I'm just gonna get one. And I did. And then I practiced on him, but I had to teach myself how to groom him. And, you know, I may be a little slow, but it took me 12 years to learn. So then when I got Hanna, step up,
Step up.
Good boy. When I got Hanna, I already knew how to groom one. And so, you know, it was pretty exciting having, because when I got Hank, I couldn't afford a good one. So I learned how to groom them, but he wasn't a super nice quality dog. And so when I got Hanna and she was like this one, really well built, it was really exciting. All right, buddy, we're making progress. We're gonna make it on time. But it was really hard learning how to groom one because I couldn't touch one that was groomed. I couldn't see the depth of hair that I was looking at. So groomers are always way too inclined to leave too much hair on this dog. It looks like a lot of hair, but let me show you how much hair this is. Because that's the big question mark that so many groomers have. It's like, this looks like a ton of hair. And when they scissor him, just like he was when I started him, way too much. So let me show you. This is my comb. Stick my comb in his back. See how much comb is still sticking up? It's not that much hair. Here, get it like this. So here, it's hard to get the angle. No, don't sit. Sorry, guys. Stand. Get the angle here so you can see the depth of hair. Because this is part of the big question mark. See how much comb is still sticking up above the hair? He's really quite short. I don't know if you can see this angle. So what makes him look so full is you're going down into these fuller legs where the comb, you know, disappears. The comb disappears in the neck. So all this is really tight. And getting it really tight is half the battle. And sometimes you're scared to pull it in as tight as this is. But this is, I used a zero comb and then scissored it shorter from there. So it's really short. So if you get your hands in the coat, here it's, right here, it's about a 5-blade length is about how short I take right here. So it's really short and then builds up into longer hair. He wants a rest. I'm going to let him do that while I do his head.
Right? You need to sleep? Does he need sleepy times? Does he need to feed? Huh? Does he need sleepy times? Oh, he does. Stay. You can lay down. Down.
And the chest I took with a 5-blade, so that's how short that is. So I'm gonna let him rest and I'm gonna thin out his face.
Good boy. You wanna lay down? Lay down? No, not get down. I don't want you to get down, no.
So basically, I guess what I'm trying to say is you don't have to be a show groomer to be a good groomer. You don't have to, you know, have these amazing quality dogs to put a good groom on a dog. My first carry was poor quality because I couldn't afford a good one, but he looked amazing all the time. So I'm going to lift this hair up here. I don't know if you can see this, but to me, this is way off wrong. See how that hair is just chunked out there? I'm surprised by that. It is just gone here. So what I'm gonna do is I'm gonna bring my thinning shears in. I'm gonna take one swipe up in there, take my fine tooth comb, comb it out, lift it up again, take another swipe, comb it out, and I'm gonna keep doing that until this is natural and it is lean and that chunked out piece of hair has disappeared into a nice long lean head. It almost looks like it was scissored out, and it should never be scissored out, especially from, like, you don't comb it out and scissor it off. You thin it out. So you comb it up, take your thinning shear, put it up under, swipe, comb it down, take a look at it, see if it's coming down lean, if it's still poking out there a little bit, comb it up, take your thinning shear in, one swipe. Don't go three or four swipes. Just don't. Go one at a time until this head comes down nice and lean. So right here, I don't like what that's doing. So I'm gonna take his head, come this way, and pull off with my thinning shears. Flatten that down. So see how it's flattening? So there we go, that's looking better. So now we're gonna go to the other side of the head, so let's turn him this way. So this side doesn't look as bad as the other side looked. This side actually looks better. You are so welcome, the Joyful Hound. Because these are the things you don't get to learn, right? These are the things that are hard to find. And while these things are not things that just anybody wants to learn, some people do. So we're going to come up under, one swipe, comb it. And I like these fine Utsumi combs to pull that right on out. Comb it up and out. Come up under. One swipe, comb it down. That's taking shape, right? So I'm not liking this right here. So I'm gonna just blend this down just a hair. So you see this length under here and how it comes forward? That's because I shaved it all the way up into the flue. Looks like he's got a little piece there that needs to come. And by shaving, when I shave the face, I lifted this up. OK, came all the way to the flue and just leave this little beard going forward, then when you drop all this back down, it creates this long, lean head. And then the head should come straight on down with nothing jutting out the side here like this is. Be sure not to take the fall. Take a little bit more in here. It's always tempting to go in with two swipes, but just do one at a time. So now that's looking better. So remember when I said I was going to save going in up over the ears till I got this part of the head done? Now I'm going to take my 15 blade and carve in a little bit more to lean out the head just a little bit more. And those super subtle differences make all the difference. So I'm going to roll his ear down and take my 15 blade and get it tighter. And basically, I like to go just below, like the National Dog Groomers Association book said, right where the ear meets the head. Well, I actually go in a little deeper and carve out this because it's gonna add to the arch of the neck and it's gonna add to the leanness of the head. And those subtle differences really, really can change how a dog looks. Blend down in through here. So now I'm gonna come up behind the ear. And I'm gonna clean all this out and come back in a little further with my 15 blade to give us more arch here. Do the same thing on this side. Actually come in deeper. Now we can go back over this. Let's see where we're at. Ears up. There we go. That's looking good right there. Now, when the ears are up, I want that top of the skull and the ears to be right about the same level so that it looks flat throughout. All right. Whew. We have, I'd say 15 minutes left, and then I would need to clean my table and present him. So let's go ahead and start working on pulling the last bit of this together and fine-tuning it, scrunching up those curls. And his body has dried in time. It's very slightly damp now. So by wetting him down, no, you're not supposed to see his beautiful eyes, Tina. He's got a fall. See? And actually, we can take, we can arc in this tight here, get it tighter in through there. So I'm going to take my 10 blade, and I'm actually going to come down tighter in through here. That added arc to his neck right there. Let's do that on the other side. Come on, bud.
Turn, 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 turn. Good boy.
Now I'm gonna take a 7 blade and go over it a little bit more, tighter in through the shoulder. Going that on down. I always did mine with a 7 on down. So I'm just gonna take him on down too. That's what I'm talking about. Now we're starting to get the arc. Take my chunkers. Get them even tighter right in through here, which is going to add to his neck. It's all about style. Now this, I can fluff out a little more, get him more length. So when they had that dog grooming show on TV, I would have thought that good grooming, just simple good grooming, would have been what they were shooting for, rather than all the coloring and all that. I think people would have loved to have seen more good grooming and less extreme grooming. It would have been much more enjoyable to me personally, you know, to see that level of work, which is not easy. Now, all the coloring and the art is really cool too. But personally, I just love, what are you doing? I just love good quality grooming and good natural dogs. I think a natural dog can be stunning, and it can be art all at the same time. So I'm actually taking a 7 blade right here because I really want to get that down low. So when I started him, he had so much hair between his back legs that I could not even see between his legs. This was all hair. There was probably 6 inches of hair in here coming off each side. And that does not create a nice, powerful driving rear when it's all covered up by hair. Stay. So it should drop straight on down on the inside there, even though you've hollowed out the muscles so that you can see, you know, you can see the muscle in the back of the leg. From here on down, you want to just drop it straight onto the ground. I was hoping my lighter colored smocks would have come in so I wouldn't have black up against this dog, but they didn't. So I'm gonna groom him again in May, and we will not have the mountain of coat to work with in May, which means I'll be able to pull them into a really nice, stylish, tight trim before he goes to Westminster. And that will be a lot more fun because I'll be able to, like, do my thing even better. Off and see where we're at. Get to show out on this kind of grooming very much because mostly all I do these days is pet grooming, and I only, you know, do small dogs. So it's fun to me to be able to occasionally do stuff like this. This client also has a champion Airedale who is clippered, and I asked her if I can borrow her Airedale to do an Airedale video for you guys for a nice pet trim on an Airedale. So I don't know if any of you guys would be interested in seeing that, but I'm gonna set up for her to bring in the, it's okay, I know you wanna lay down, I'm sorry. We're almost done, we got 9 minutes till it's scissors down time. 9 minutes. You can stand for 9 more minutes, right? So when this tail's down, you don't want to see it bunching up. It's okay. You don't want to see it bunching up off the back. So while I want it, I want this full of hair here, I also don't want it sticking up when his tail's down. So when he drops his tail, I'm going to take it straight off. And then it should have enough fill left. And that's why I'm willing to do these dogs that are bigger than what I work on for you guys, is because I want to be able to show you, put your foot down, you goof. I want to be able to show you some of what I've learned over the years without having to groom them professionally. I'm not charging for this dog today. I signed up this dog today and asked for him to be brought here so I could show you guys how to do a carry, but I did him for free. because I wanted him for you. So whenever I have a dog that I'm doing that with, I typically, when I do the Airedale, it'll be for free. It's not a grooming client. It's just for you guys. That's my whole goal, is just to be able to share and document some of these so that you can see them. And of course, this video will stay up there for you guys so that if you ever do get one in your shop or you get to groom one as a professional, you know, you can have some reference material that's easy to access. So when I get done with him and after I check him out, what I'm going to do is, yeah, I know you want to lay down, go over a little bit about the breed standard and stuff like that, just to add to the video for people who want to learn about them and the breed history.
Right? Are you tired? What's he mad at you? Huh? You know how to give a five? Can you give a five? Huh? Can you? He says, I'm tired. This has been a very long day for me. Yeah.
So I'm gonna work a little bit more. He does have still too much hair over the eyes and at the, looking at the width here. You wanna see him move? I can ask his owner when she, well, I can, when his owner gets here, I'll take him out front and see him move. I haven't seen him move with his hair yet, and sometimes once I see a Kerry move, it's like, oh crap, I gotta fix that. So, yeah, I can move him. I'd like to do it outside, but I'll probably just do it up and down the hallway here. Where is your leash? I put you on the, oh, I didn't do your belly yet, did I? Let's do your belly. Up, up, up. So I waited till I got the entire underline before I did the belly, so I could see right where I could go with clippers safely and not screw up his underline. Because I can tell you with my female, it's so easy to mess up the underline when you trim the belly. So I never do it first. I've learned to always do it last. Take you guys out back and I'll move him down and back. Then I can see what he looks like too. After I look at the video, and so I'll say, oh no. Oh shoot, they're back.
They're back.
Well, there goes that eye. I'll bring him out in a few minutes. I'm One time my mom was working up under a standard poodle like this and she had his leg picked up and he peed right on her head. I'll never forget that. I was about 10 years old. I cracked up. She was not happy. To say the least. Yep, that was one wig in the trash for sure. All right, back up so they can see your head. Purdy Carrie Blue. Right, buddy? One pretty. Oh, is you happy? Is you a happy boy? Is a happy boy?
He's like, I am. I'm almost done. I get to go home. I get to go home now. Yes. He's a good boy.
Yeah, he's a good boy. Thin a little bit more out of that head. So we will. Come here, bud. I'm gonna go grab my scissors. I'll be right back. So he's looking a little too wide in the head to me right now. So I need to take a bit more of that. So I'm going to pull this to the side, pull this out, go in with two swipes, comb it out. That's better. There we go. All right, let's go check him out. And where's the boy? Where's the boy? Huh? Where's the boy? Huh? Where's the boy? You want to go bye-byes? Do you want to go bye-byes? Where's your mama? Where's your mama? Let's go find her. Come on, let's go find your mama. This is probably the primary study material for the National Dog Groomers Association testing. And this is like the Bible of the breeds, basically. So, let's see here. This is where you get your breed standards from. And how you know what a dog is supposed to be. JK. So we're going to look at the Kerry Blue Terrier. And this will be a little bit more accurate than what we were looking at earlier. So the history of the Kerry Blue Terrier is shrouded with myth and legend, much like the mists of the shores of Ireland's coastline where the breed originated. One romantic yarn puts forward that the Kerry or Irish Blue Terrier arose from a black, soft-coated dog who swam ashore from the remnants of the Spanish Armada on the western coast of Ireland. The breed became a herder of sheep and cows, a stalker and dispatcher of vermin, a hunter and retriever of small game on land and water. The first Kerry to compete at a dog show appeared in Limerick in 1887 as a silver-haired Irish Terrier, according to the account of Alan Lewis. These dogs were also seen at a show in Southern County Kerry, but not until the formation of the Irish Republic did Kerrys begin to appear in dog shows throughout Ireland, encouraged in part by their association. Originally, Kerrys were shown untrimmed in Ireland, so they were just a big, shaggy, curly-haired dog. But they became more popular throughout Europe, and the English began grooming the breed for confirmation. The Kennel Club provided the regular classification for the breed in 1922. That same year, Kerrys were recognized by the AKC and appeared at the Westminster Kennel Club Dog Show. The fusion of the Kerry Blue Terrier Club of America and the United States Kerry Blue Terrier Club both started in the 1920s. So the form and function of a Kerry Blue Terrier. The Kerry is of medium height, 33 to 40 pounds, upstanding, well-balanced, and muscled. He has an open, free-flowing gait, which is what I told you when I trimmed up under the arms so that his legs could swing like a pendulum. That's that open, free-flowing gait. So you really have to, in understanding the breed standard and how to apply it to the groom, getting up under those arms and scissoring out that hair and bringing the rib cage down around behind those front legs so those legs would be seen as free-flowing. That's important. The breed size and structure made a formidable hunter and a driven herder. From the 1920s to the 1960s, one of the requirements to gain championship in Ireland was for the Kerry to go to ground in a badger lair and bring out prey. So he had to go into the badger hole, grab a badger, and bring it out to become a champion. They're tenacious. While born black, the coat color matures to a blue-gray that allows for a wide spectrum of shade. Living with a Kerry. Kerry Blues are gentle, lovable, and intelligent working terriers, including such jobs as assistance work, therapy, search, and rescue. They are faithful family companions who show great versatility, personality, and energy. A responsible breeder will help the novice understand the requirements of the breed, its temperament, space, and exercise requirements, necessary training, socialization, and grooming. All dogs benefit from training, and the Kerry's intelligent make him an apt student who flourishes with some structure and positive reinforcement. The Kerry's soft, non-shedding, medium size, and love of non-shedding coat, medium size, and love of children make him an ideal house dog and a loving addition to a family. His temperament and intelligence allow him to be a wonderful guardian of the home, playmate for the children, and eager companion, whether he's fetching a ball or curling up beside you as you read. Kerrys are adaptable to apartment living as well as to the farm environment. Grooming is essential to maintain their beautiful, soft, luscious coat. The non-shedding aspect of their coat requires that it be brushed thoroughly at least once a week and trimmed every 4 to 6 weeks. In general, the Kerrys are healthy, long-lived, and will retain their activeness of their whole 12 to 15-year lifespan. So that's basically the Kerry in a nutshell. They're amazing, amazing dogs. And like I said, I'm surprised that you don't see more of them. You see so many doodles and mini doodles and all those types of dogs, but there's so many amazing, amazing dogs that you should really consider. You should really look at if you're thinking about a dog. Well, apartment living, they're good guard dogs. I wouldn't necessarily have one in an apartment, but being it's 33 to 40 pounds, you know, it's a nice size dog. And as long as you give them plenty of exercise, it wouldn't hurt anything. All right, guys, I'm gonna log off. I am done for the day. I've got paperwork to do and then I'll be heading home. So it was fun and I had fun doing him. So I'll see you guys tomorrow and we'll try to come up with something fun. Bye.